person, or I'll be asking a particular person who is who knows well about my organization's network profile, and I'll be asking that person, like, what is happening? I don't know what is happening. So the person to whom I have asked, he might work like a hacker, and he might evaluate the security profile of my organization. Okay, like how a hacker does. He might check what all vulnerabilities are there in the network, in the servers, in what all infrastructure that I have. So there comes the role of an ethical hacker. Okay, so he can be the person to which to whom I have given the job. He can be called as an ethical hacker, because he thinks like a hacker. Okay, he thinks like a hacker, and he one second, give me a minute. Is it audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So I thought there was some problem with the net connection. So he might think that I haven't shared any PPT or anything. So I'll be sharing that soon. Okay. So so the person whom I have assigned this particular job, he can be considered as an ethical hacker. He thinks like a hacker, and he works like how all a hacker thinks to get into the system. Okay. So the person whom I have designated this job, he is called the ethical hacker. Okay, he is doing the hacking process with my permission. Understood? That is what an ethical hacker is. Okay, so being an ethical hacker, so if you want to be an ethical hacker, you should know a lot of things, like you should have a very good information about the operational environment. Okay, then you should have very much knowledge about the certain programming languages like Python. Okay, you should have a very good knowledge about the networking infrastructure. You should have a knowledge on infrastructure as well. Okay, network infrastructure as well. Okay, and again, ethical hacker is an asset to the organization. So to back such positions, it will be really good if you have an ethical hacking certification as well. And Easy Council is one such organization which is giving you an ethical hacking certification. Okay, so I'm going to present the slide now. So we'll start with what ethical hacking is right now, and then we'll go to the first phase in ethical hacking. Okay, so what is hacking? So that is the first slide which I have been showing here. So hacking means, it refers to exploiting the system vulnerabilities and compromising the security controls to gain unauthorized or inappropriate access to the system resources. So like what I have said, exploiting the system vulnerabilities, each and every, so depending upon what all I have installed in my machine. Okay, suppose if I have installed, my operating system is Microsoft Windows, so that Windows will be having lot of vulnerabilities that have not been patched, or I might not have updated the security patches that Microsoft has given. So that could be called as a vulnerability. Or say I'm using my organization is using an Apache web server. Okay, so Apache web server might be having certain vulnerabilities. So those vulnerabilities will be exploited by the hacker. Exploited means taken use by the, that will be taken use, it will be used by the hacker, and he compromises the security controls for what? To gain unauthorized or inappropriate access to the system resources. Okay, so it involves, it could modifying system or application features, which is for achieving a goal outside of the creator's original purpose. Okay, so hacking on computer networks, it could be done by means of scripts, okay, or other network programming. Okay, network hacking technique means it includes, using viruses, using backdoor programs, using performing denial of service attacks. Okay, so using Trojans, a lot of things are there. Okay, so these are some of the network hacking techniques. So what is hacking for? Hacking can be used to steal, pilfer, and redistribute, intellectual property, leading to business loss. Okay, so who is a hacker? Who is a hacker? It can be an intelligent individual with excellent computer skills, okay, with the ability to create and explore into the computer software and hardware. Okay, for some hackers, hacking will be a hobby to see, like, I just want to know, like, how good I am in hacking. So I want to check how many computers or how many networks I can compromise. Okay, so that could be the reason of a particular hacker to do this hacking. So some their intention can either be to gain knowledge or, to just to poke around to do illegal things. Okay, so anyway, in a nutshell, I can say that a hacker should be an intelligent individual. So a normal person who doesn't have any flair in networking, who doesn't have any flair in, doing such things, cannot perform hacking. Hacking means you should have a flair in that. You should have a flair in doing such thing. He should have excellent computer skills. Okay, then only he'll be able to explore into the, a person's computer in which he or she is interested. Okay. So that is what a hacker would be, a skilled engineer, or it could be a programmer with enough knowledge to discover vulnerability target system. Okay. Now, again, the hacker classes. You have different types of hacker classes. So we have the black hats, we have white hats, we have a blend of the two. They are called gray hats. Okay. You have suicide hackers, you have script kiddies, you have cyber terrorists, you have state-sponsored hackers. These are the different classes of hackers. Now, what are black hat, hackers? So black hats are individuals, they use their extraordinary computer skilling for such illegal or malicious purpose. Okay, this category of hacker is often involved with criminal activities, and they are also known as crackers. They are involved with criminal activities or destructive activities. They do malicious things. They are called black hats. They are always categorized as black hats. Okay, now white hats, or they could be, again, another name for them is penetration testers. Okay, they are persons who use their hacking skills for defensive purpose. The organization will give permission to a white hat hacker to do such things, to do, like, to think like a hacker, and that is for defending, okay, for defensive purpose. So these days, almost every organization, they have security analysts, who are very much, they know about the hacking countermeasures, which can secure the network and, information system. Okay, they have the permissions from the system owner. Now, gray hats, like what I have said, it is a blend of black and white. Okay, so they work both offensively and defensively. Okay, they fall between white and black hats. Okay, the gray hats, they might help the hackers in finding various vulnerabilities. They might, the malicious persons, the ordinary hackers, the gray hats may help those hackers, and they may get money from the hackers as well by exposing. They may find the various vulnerabilities of a system and they may give it to the hacker. Okay, so such things, we say that they are doing it offensively, and at the same time they also help the vendors to improve the products as well. Okay, now we have the suicide hackers. Suicide hackers means what? They are individuals who bring down critical infrastructure. They are bringing it down for a cause. Okay, and they are not worried about what will happen. Now, if they are found, like if they are found as doing such malicious process, they are not at all worried about the jailing terms or any other kind of punishment. They are similar to suicide bombers, who sacrifice their life for the attacks and all. So those category of people are called suicide hackers. Then we have the script kiddies. Script kiddies means what? They are unskilled hackers. They do not have any knowledge. They do not have any knowledge. Now, what they do is they compromise the system by using the scripts which are created by, which are generated by other people. They are called script kiddies. They use the scripts, tools and softwares which are developed by the real hackers. They just want to focus on the, you know, how many they have attacked. They just want to focus on the number of attacks they have made. So they are not, you know, a skilled hacker. So such category of people can be classified as script kiddies. Then we have the cyber terrorists. So cyber terrorists means like what it is given over here. They have a wide range of skills. They might be motivated by religious or political beliefs to create fear of large-scale disruption of computer networks. So they are categorized as cyber terrorists. Then there may be state-sponsored hackers, sponsored by the government, individuals who are employed by the government, you know, to gain some top secret information about other governments as well, and to damage such information. So they are called state-sponsored hackers. Now, hacktivists. Hacktivists means what? Hacktivists means they use hacking to increase awareness of their social or political agenda. They will be having some sort of social or political agenda in both online and offline arenas. They are individuals, you know, they promote a political agenda by hacking. What do? They deface certain websites or they disable websites and they promote their political agenda or maybe some social agenda. So that is what is called a hacktivist. So these are some of the hacker classes. Now we have certain, when it comes to hacking, it is not all in one. Like you cannot just hack into a system like that. So now there are certain steps that has to be followed in hacking. Now what are the steps? There are, there are almost five phases in hacking. There are five steps in hacking, where the first phase is called reconnaissance, or we call it as footprinting. That is the first phase. The second phase is called scanning. The third phase is called gaining access. Fourth one is called maintaining access. And fifth one is called clearing the tracks. So this is how a hacking, this is what, these are the different phases of hacking. So it doesn't mean that like when we hear about hacking, it is very easy to hack into a particular system or into a particular network. It shouldn't be thought of in that way. So hacking means there is a particular phase which has to be followed. The first phase is what is called reconnaissance. Now, what do you mean by reconnaissance? Reconnaissance means it is a phase in which the attacker, you know, gathers as much information about the what target. So based on what he is going to hack, he is going to hack a particular network or whatever he is going to hack. So he will be, gaining lot of information about that particular target. That is what comes in the reconnaissance phase. In this phase, actually, there will be, the attacker will have a competitive intelligence to learn more about the target. And this is a future point of return, for ease of entry. So after studying about the target, after getting all information about the target, we say that the person, after the reconnaissance phase, we get a blueprint of the network of the organization or whatever. And this will be the return path. This will be the entry point for the hacker to get into the system. He studies about the network. He studies about all the security profile of the target. And then he decides how to get into the system. Understood? So that comes in reconnaissance. So reconnaissance, the target may be the organization's clients, employees, operations being done, network systems, etc. That comes in the reconnaissance phase. So in the slide here, it is given, like, reconnaissance refers to the preparatory phase where an attacker seeks to gather information about a target prior to launching an attack, like what I have said earlier. So could be the future point of return, okay? Noted for ease of entry for an attack when more about the target is known. Understood? So the target area could be reduced, the focus area could be reduced. Once after knowing the entire profile of the organization about the target, the person can reduce the focus area so that he doesn't have to spend his time, you know, on the other things. He can reduce the focus area. So now there are two types of reconnaissance. One is passive reconnaissance and another one is called active reconnaissance. So passive reconnaissance means what? The hacker will not be, you know, the hacker for acquiring the information, he will not be directly interacting with the target. That is called passive reconnaissance. Okay, so he may be getting the information about the target from public, like say from search engines. Okay, so from the publicly available information, he'll be gathering all such data. Active reconnaissance means what? Interacting with the target directly. It involves interacting with the target directly. For example, say a telephone call to the help desk, or say saying that, okay, I'm a person who tries to, who is looking out for a job in that particular company. I would like to know what all posts are there. So that is again called an active reconnaissance, wherein, you know, I'm directly interacting with the target. So these are the two types of reconnaissance that we have. We'll be dealing in detail with the reconnaissance phase today. Okay. Then the next phase is, you know, scanning phase. Okay. So after the reconnaissance phase, we have the scanning phase. So scanning phase means that that is a phase immediately preceding the attack. Okay, it is called the pre-attack phase. Okay, so here the attacker, what he does is he'll use the details gathered during the reconnaissance phase to scan the network. Okay, and all, like what operating system is being used by the server. What all ports are open? What all ports are being used? What all services are being used? Okay, so all such details, all such things are being done in the scanning phase. So it is, you can say that it is an extension of active reconnaissance. Okay. Scanning refers to the pre-attack phase when the attacker scans the network for specific information on the basis of information gathered during reconnaissance. So scanning can include use of dialers, port scanners, network mappers, ping tools, vulnerability scanners, etc. I think network scanning will be covered as a different module for you all. Okay. Now, attackers in the scanning phase, he can also extract information such as which are the live machines, which are the machines that are working 24/7. Okay. Like what I have said, how which all ports are there. What is the status of the ports? Are the ports open or are they closed? Now, what is the which operating system is being used by the server? Okay, or say which all scripting languages is being used? Okay, what is the device type? What is the uptime of the system, etc.? So all such information will be you know, extracted during the scanning phase. So this is the second phase of hacking. Okay. Now, the third phase is gaining access. Okay. Now, what do you mean by gaining access? So this is the phase in which the real hacking occurs. Okay. So what all vulnerabilities have been identified during the reconnaissance and scanning phase, that will be used to gain access to the target system. Okay. So what do you mean by gaining access? The attacker is obtaining access through the operating system. So it could be at the operating system level or it could be at the application level. Anyhow, so whatever the hacker is interested in, so based on the operating system level or application level, the hacker will gain access to the system, okay, on the computer or on the network. So, or it could be at the network level as well. Now, the attacker, now after getting into the system, what he can do is he can escalate his privileges. So he can get the super user privilege. So he can escalate his privilege. He can do anything on the system now. He has gained access. Okay, so he can escalate the privileges to get the complete control of the system. Okay, then he can install some backdoors. Okay, he can install some sort of backdoor programs which will do the malicious process. And he will remain, and the process will remain unnoticed by the user. So the attacker can escalate privileges to obtain the complete control of the system. Okay, in this process, intermediate systems which are connected to the target system, they will also be compromised. So what all? So examples include password cracking, buffer overflow. He can perform a denial of service. He can hijack the server. Okay, he can perform a hacking of the web server. Whatever he wants, he can do. So that is what is happening in the gaining access phase. Okay. Now, the next phase is the maintaining access phase. So once a hacker has got into the system, now he has to maintain his access there. Isn't it? So it refers to the phase when the attacker is trying to retain his or her ownership of the system. Okay, so once an attacker gains access to the target system with the super user privilege, he will be able to use both the system and its resources. Okay, he can do anything in the system, and what he will do is he will be preventing the same system being owned by other hackers. Assume that another attacker is also trying to intrude into the same system. So the first hacker, since he is having the super user privilege, he can prevent that particular attack. So attackers may prevent the system from being owned by other attackers by securing their exclusive access. So what can the attacker do? He can do anything. He can upload files, he can download files, he can manipulate the data, applications and configuration on the system in which he has got into. Okay, and he uses this system to launch further attacks. So this is the fourth phase. Okay, maintaining access. And the last phase that we have is the clearing tracks phase. Now, what do you mean by clearing tracks? Clearing tracks means it refers to the activities carried out by an attacker to hide the malicious acts. So, to maintain access, okay, and for other reasons, the attackers will usually attempt to, to clear off all the evidences of their actions in the target machine. Okay, so clearing track, like what they have said, it refers to the, activities carried out by an attacker to hide his attacks. The attacker's intentions include continuing access to the victim system. He should be unnoticed. So that is why he is clearing all the tracks. He is clearing all the logs. He doesn't even, he makes sure that nothing is there, so that the person who is owning the system or a network administrator, okay, will be able to notice that such a thing has happened or such a backdoor has been injected into the system. Okay, so he tries to remain unnoticed and uncaught, and he tries to delete evidence that might lead to his prosecution as well if he is getting caught. If he is caught, it should not lead to his prosecution, so that is why he tries to delete the evidence as well. So he might override the server, system and application logs to avert suspicion. So either the logs would be cleared or he would try to override that, or whatever he wants he can do. But the main purpose of this particular phase is clear the track so that he remains unnoticed. When I say that he remains unnoticed, the backdoor or whatever malicious thing he has performed in that particular machine, that should remain unnoticed. See, installing a backdoor, installing such sort of malicious programs that will be doing the malicious process, in a certain interval of time. So that should remain unnoticed. That is what remaining unnoticed means. So these are the five phases of hacking. So this should be done accordingly. That is how a hacker does the hacking. So the first phase, like what I have said, it is called reconnaissance, or it is called footprinting, wherein as much of information about the target is being collected. Okay, second is, depending upon whatever information has been gathered in the reconnaissance phase, okay, that will be used in the scanning phase, which is the second phase of hacking. And they try to get more information about the network or the other details about the organization. Like they'll try to get the, you know, network blocks, okay, which all IPs are being used, like what we have discussed earlier. Now, once all such things have been gathered by the hacker, now he has a very good idea about the target. Now he knows how to get into the system because he knows what all vulnerabilities are present in the system, and he tries to exploit that vulnerability. Okay, he tries to exploit the vulnerability by, you know, by doing some sort of, by executing some sort of payloads and all, and he tries to get into the system. That is what is called gaining access. He tries to gain access into the system, and you know, and he becomes a super user by escalating all his privileges so that now he has complete control over the system. Okay, he can do whatever he wants on the system. And the fourth phase is the maintaining access phase, where the person maintains his access there. Okay, he, you know, if other hackers are trying to get into the system, he tries to prevent that. He uses a compromised system to perform, you know, further attacks as well. And the last phase is what is called the clearing track phase, wherein all the you know, evidence will be cleared off so that he remains unnoticed and uncaught. Okay, so now so that is the that is what is called hacking. Hacking for a malicious purpose. Okay, hacking for, like what you know, black hat hackers does. Okay, now we'll see what is ethical hacking. Okay, now what is ethical hacking? Hacking. So it is the practice of, you know, using the computer and network skills in order to assist the organizations for what? For testing their network security, to check whether there are any loopholes or vulnerabilities in the network. So that is what ethical hacking means. Okay, all the skills will be used in a good way. It is used for a good, in a good manner. Okay, so that the network security of a particular organization can be checked for any loopholes or vulnerability. So the ethical hacker, what he does is he thinks like an ethical hacker should think like a hacker, and he should know like what all things a hacker does to get into the system. So he has to follow exactly the same way, and he has to figure out what all, he has to figure out what are the vulnerabilities present in the particular security profile of that particular organization. Okay, so ethical hacking involves the use of hacking tools, tricks and techniques to identify vulnerabilities so as to ensure the system security. Like they are called, like what we have said, they are called the white hat hackers, or they are called penetration testers. Okay, so they perform hacking with the permission of the network or system owner. Okay, and they won't cause any harm. Okay, they report all the vulnerabilities, okay, for remediation, and thereby they increase the security of an organization's information system. Okay, so it focuses on simulating techniques used by the attackers to verify the existence of exploitable vulnerabilities in the system security. Okay, so that is what I have discussed right now. They perform the security assessment of their organization with the permission of the concerned, you know, authorities. Now, why is ethical hacking necessary? Huh? So to be like, this is what I have been saying all the time. To beat a hacker, you need to think like one, isn't it? Ethical hacking is necessary as it allows counter attacks from malicious hackers by anticipating methods used by them to break into a system. Okay, you know that as you know, technology is growing at a very faster pace, so the number of risk associated with it is also growing. So that is why ethical hacking has become necessary. So reasons why organizations recruit ethical hackers: to prevent hackers from gaining access to organizations' information system. Okay, so once the vulnerabilities are listed out by the ethical hacker, now the organization can think of patching it out so that it will prevent the hacker from gaining access to the information system of the organization. To uncover the vulnerabilities in system and explore their potential as a risk. to analyze and strengthen an organization's security posture, which includes policies, network protection infrastructure, and end user practices. So these are the things which we have been discussing all this time. To provide adequate preventive measures in order to avoid security breaches, to help safeguard the customer's data, and to enhance the security awareness. Okay. An ethical hacker should always try to answer to the three basic questions, like what can an attacker see on the target system? Okay. And what can an intruder do with that information? And are the attacker's attempts being noticed on the target system? Understood. So these three questions should be answered. So this is what an ethical hacker does. Okay, he tries to get answers for these three basic questions, like what all can he see from this target system, and what all he has seen, is it will that information alone can allow the hacker to get into the system? Okay, what can the hacker do with that information? And if a hacker gets into the system, will his attempts, or if he, when he tries to, like, you know, don't ever think that a hacker can get into a particular system in his first try itself, in his first attempt itself. It may be after a, you know, a number of attempts that he gets into the system. So if a person is trying to get into the system, will his attempt, can it be noticed by the target system? Can it be noticed on the target system? So these are some of the questions that has to be answered by the ethical. They try to seek answers for these questions so that at that point they'll be knowing that, okay, this particular system or this particular network is vulnerable. There are a lot of things which are exposed to the public through which the hacker can get into the system. So these all things has to be handled very well. Okay. So ethical hackers try to answer the following question: what can the intruder see on the target system? So that could be done in the reconnaissance and scanning phase. So what all phases the hacker does to get into the system, the ethical hacker also performs all those steps. What can an intruder do with that information? So can he gain access? Will he be able to maintain access? Does anyone at the target notice the intruder's attempts or success? If he has got into the system, will anybody, will the target system be able to notice that? Okay, so intruder's attempts means while trying to gather information actively, okay? So that comes under the reconnaissance phase, and, you know, trying to cover the tracks means covering track spaces. If all the components of the information system are adequately protected, updated, and patched, okay? The, you know, the correct version of the software is being used. Is it the licensed version that is being used? Are they being updated regularly? Okay. If there are any vulnerabilities and patches of those vulnerabilities have been released, are they being updated? Are they being adequately protected? How much effort, time, and money is required to obtain adequate protection? Okay. Are the information security measures in compliance with industry and legal standards? So they try to answer these following questions. So what are the skills of an ethical hacker? So ethical hacker, like what I have said earlier, and hacker should be a person who should have a very good, operational knowledge about everything. Okay. So similarly, an ethical hacker should also have a very good knowledge about the operational environment, like if it is a Windows machine, Unix machine, Linux machine, or if it is a Mac machine. So he should have a, depending upon which operating system he is trying to, you know, check. So he should have a knowledge of the major operating environments. So he should have in-depth knowledge of the networking concepts, technologies, related hardware and software. Okay, he or she should be a computer expert. Okay. Should have knowledge of security areas and related issues, and high technical knowledge to launch the sophisticated attacks. So these are the skills of an ethical hacker. When I say that these are the skills of an ethical hacker, this will be the skill of a malicious hacker as well. Okay. what are the non-technical skills? Now, some of the non-technical skills or characteristics that the ethical hacker should have is the ability to learn and adapt new technologies quickly. So he might not be knowing the technologies that is used by the target organization. So he should have the ability to learn that, and he should adapt to that very quick. Okay, he should have strong work ethics and good problem solving and communication skills, and he should be committed to the organization security policies. Okay, so he has got access. He has got access to the network, to the organization's network. He shouldn't harm that. He shouldn't take advantage of that particular access. Okay, so he should be committed to the organization security policies, and he should be aware of all the local standards and the cyber laws, so that if at all, he's trying to perform any harm, that should be taken care of. Okay. So now what we are going to do is we are going to see the first phase of hacking, which is footprinting recognition. Is there an echo coming? I could hear that. Yeah. Is it because of my audio or is it because of everybody is hearing that? Huh? Now, is it okay? No echo is there?
No.
Yeah. Thanks. So, the first phase of ethical hacking, which is called footprinting and reconnaissance. Okay. So, what is footprinting? We have already discussed what footprinting is, isn't it? So footprinting means what? Identifying the, what do you say, the level of risk associated with the organization's publicly accessible information. Now, when I say that no information about an organization should be publicly accessible, that is not possible, isn't it? There will be some information which has to be publicly accessible. But those information which is publicly accessible, what is the level of risk associated with that? Understood. That is the aspect of footprinting. What all you are getting, what all you are getting from the publicly available information. So this is a first step in ethical hacking. Okay. And it refers to the process of collecting information about a target network and its environment. Okay. Now, like what we have discussed earlier, we have got two types of footprinting: passive footprinting and active footprinting. Okay. Passive footprinting means without the, you are getting, trying to gather information about the target without, you know, direct interaction. It could be through search engines. Okay. Like whatever. Now, nowadays, if, you know, we use Google. Google has a very extensive use, isn't it? So whenever we want to know about anything, we just search about that in Google. Isn't it? So that is, you can find about a particular organization from the search engines. You have different search engines as well. You get the top level domains and subdomains of a target. Okay, top level domains means, for example, when I say Microsoft, so www.microsoft.com, that is a top level domain, and it will be having different subdomains as well. So getting the subdomains of a particular organization means what? I'll be knowing what all departments are there in that particular organization. Okay, so we can get that through various web services available. Okay, now getting the location information on the target. The location, where is it? Okay, where is actually that particular organization located? So that, is there any cameras or anything, you know, near that particular area, so that, you know, we can get more information. See, reconnaissance, the goal of that particular phase is gather as much information as possible. There isn't any particular methodology that has to be followed. Understood. In this module, we'll be seeing a lot of methodologies. And again, I'm saying that, I'm personally saying that you shouldn't, it is not required that only these methods has to be followed. There can be a lot of other methods as well. But the only goal is collect as much information as possible. Okay. Now, you get information about the people working in the organization through the social networking sites. And the people search services as well. You get the financial information about the target. Okay, so getting the financial information about the target, you will be knowing like what is the current market share of that particular organization. That might be, you know, that might be of use to the hacker. Okay, so getting the financial information, getting the infrastructure details of the target organization through job sites. Okay, job sites are there. What do you get from job sites? You get like, now suppose particular organization is looking out for a web developer, and these are the you know, skills the candidate should have. So from that itself, the hacker will be able to know that, okay, these technologies are being used in that particular company. So the hacker might look at the vulnerabilities of the technologies which are being listed in the job portals as well. Okay. You can use alert services, you can use groups, you know, forums, etc. Okay, what is the operating system which is being used? You can get the you know, you can go to, you can check the Wayback Machine, and you can get the different archives of the website of the particular organization. Okay, so you can perform social engineering on social networking sites. So that all comes under passive footprinting. Okay. Active footprinting, like what I have said, you are getting information about the target with direct interaction. So what all information is obtained in footprinting? Organization information, you get the domain and subdomains. Okay. Sorry, you get the employee details, you get the telephone numbers, location, background, etc., web technologies, etc. You get the network information, like the domain and subdomains. You get the network blocks, IP addresses, like who is record. Who is record means who is the registrar, what are the named servers. Okay, the range of IP addresses being used by the particular organization. Okay, get the DNS records, the related information, etc. Okay, and again, system information, which says what is the operating system being used by the web server. Okay, and where is the web server located? Are there any users and will I be able to get the users and passwords of any of the web servers as well as the databases for any, I want to perform a data breach. Okay, so what is the database being used in that particular organization? Okay, will I be able to get the usernames and passwords? So all such things that comes under footprinting. Okay. So what is the objective of footprinting? You know the security posture, isn't it? You perform footprinting, it gives a complete profile of the organization's security posture. And then they can, the hacker can build a hacking plan accordingly. Like what I have said earlier, it reduces the focus area as well. Now reducing the focus area means what? It by using, you know, you attackers can you know, reduce the focus area to a specific range of IP addresses in which they are interested in. No, they don't have to go to the wide range. Okay, they can reduce their focus area to the specific range of IP addresses, networks, etc. Okay, then it helps to identify what all weaknesses are there in the system. Okay, so it allows attacker to identify vulnerabilities in the target system in order to select the appropriate exploit. Appropriate exploit means how do you exploit into the system. So there are exploits for vulnerabilities, which is there in the Google hacking databases, which will be published by a lot of users in the Google hacking database as well. Okay, so after identifying the vulnerability in the system, the hacker, if he is you know, highly skilled hacker, he can create scripts of his own so that he can what, exploit that vulnerability. Now once he gets a blueprint of the organization, he can draw a network map, or he can outline the network infrastructure to know about the network they are going to break. How do they get into the system? So these are all the objective of footprinting. So now what we are going to see is we are going to see the footprinting, how to do footprinting through different methods. Okay, so the first method that we are going to use is a footprinting method through what? Search engines. So we know that there are a lot of search engines available. The most commonly used one is the Google search engine. We have Bing, we have Yahoo, we have Ask, we have AOL, we have Baidu, we have DuckDuckGo. Okay, a lot of search engines are there. And let me say that different search engines will be using different searching algorithms. So if I do a particular search for a particular for something in Google, I might get a different result when I search for that in Bing or say in Ask. So we may not be getting the same result in all the search engines. Okay, so attackers, they use a search engine to extract information about a target, like what I discussed earlier, which helps the attacker in performing social engineering and other type of advanced system attacks. So there are something called Google Docs, not Google Docs, there are something called Docs, D-O-R-K-S. Okay, Docs means what? There are certain queries, or they can be called as certain operators, which will help us to filter the search. Okay, there now, if I'm using it with the Google search engine, we call it as Google Docs. If I'm using the docs associated with Bing search engine, we call them as Bing Docs. Okay, so they are called search operators. Okay, so attackers can use, I'll show you some examples. Can use advanced search operators available with these search engines, and they can create complex queries to find, filter, and sort. I don't want to say a lot of results. Now, suppose if I'm going to search for a particular thing, we know that a lot of things will be shown by the search engine. I don't want that. I want to narrow the search. So I'm going to use Google Docs. Okay. Search engines are also used to find all other sources of publicly accessible information resources. Example, top job portals to find the major job portals which will provide critical information about the target organization. So I'm just, I'll be opening the browser now. I'll show the browser to you. Okay. Can you see the browser? Yeah, so I'm going for the, you know, Google search engine. Okay, so in this Google search engine, I told you we have got certain operators, search operators. So we are going to use those search operators now. Okay, and they are called Google Docs, like what I have said. Okay, we have something called say before that, say I'm searching something related, say Corona. Okay, so these are some of the results that comes when I search for Corona. So when you get the results, you should know something. Now this here, this one is called the URL. Okay, this is called the URL. This is called the title. Can you see this? This is called the title, and this is called the description. Okay, so this is a URL, this is called the title, and this is called the description. So this is what we get normally when we give something search. This is normally what we get. So what we have is we have some sort of operators which could be used so that we can narrow our search. For example, I am giving something like this. I'm giving something like, say, I'm using an operator. The operator is called in URL. Okay, in URL, that is the operator, and I put a full colon. Okay, and I give CDAC. Now, when I give such a search operator, when I give such a Google Doc, it says that I list out all the URLs which has a word CDAC. Okay, so I'm just going to enter this. okay, so I get results in which there will be something called CDAC in the URL. Understood? That is what is called in URL. Okay, similarly we have something called in title. In title, so when I say in title CDAC, so it will display all the results which has CDAC, only those results which has CDAC in the title. Understood? That is what is called in title. Okay, and if something like, suppose if I give like say in URL CDAC and I'm giving another search operator, the search operator is called file type, and I give a full colon, I say PDF. So in URL there should be CDAC, and I want to list out the file type of, I mean I want to list out PDF files. So I give a search, so you can see that PDF files have been listed here. Did you see that? Okay, which will give certain, see, this gives a lot of things about PDF files in CDAC. Okay, so when you get such related results, not you, a person who is interested in the organization gets such PDFs or something of that sort, he might be going through. This is not a one-day process or a two-day process. This will be, you know, a month or a lot of days process to get into a portal. So he'll be going through each and everything in detail so that he gets a lot of information. After seeing this, he'll be knowing that, I got this information. Well and good. Okay. So this will be helpful to him. Okay. So that is Google Doc operator, Google Doc. We have file type, we have in URL, then we have something called in title. So what does in title mean? When I say in title, I say that it, you know, it should be there in the title. The word that I'm looking for should be there in the title. Okay. Then there is something called, you know, link. So suppose if I give, say, like link, full colon, okay, and I give say CDAC. So this will display again all those pages which again has a link to CDAC also. Okay, so which all sites has a link to CDAC, that will also be shown in this result. So you have got a lot of results here, so you can go through that and you get all such results. So that is what link means. Link means it results a, what does it do? It lists the web pages that have links to the specified web page. Now, suppose if you want to have a cache, you want to see what was the recent cache of CDAC. Okay, so how do you give that? I give like cache colon. So since I'm having a lot of Google searches here, it's asking me for a capture there. So the recent cached version of CDAC website. Understood? Recent cached version. So from the cached version, he might get some details about CDAC. So what was a recent cache? So there is something called a Wayback Machine. There is something called archive.org from which you get all the previous versions of the websites. Understood? So this is a recent cache which was there in the Google cache of CDAC's website. So that is being listed here. So these are search operators that could be used for filtering the search as well. Okay. So we'll go back to the slide now. We have some okay. So we have cache. So these are some of the advanced search operators. We have cache, which displays the web pages stored in the Google's cache. We have link, which lists the web pages that have links to the specified web page. Now I can give an operator called related. Okay, now I want a web page which is similar to another website. So, you know, if I want to view such things, I can give the related operator. So if you want to present, if some information that Google has given for a particular web page, if you want to view that, you can use the info operator. Okay, then you have site. Okay, only those site in the given domain will only be shown. So for example, if I give like site full colon cdac.in, only those websites in the given domain, all the subdomains etc. of that particular site will only be shown in the search result when I give site full colon. Okay, then we have in title and all in title. Now what do you mean by all in title? I can give two words, okay, and the two words have to be in the title. So then I give all in title. Now simply when I give in title, what happens? I can give only one word, so that it checks only for that word in the title and it displays those pages in the search result. So all in title and all in URL will be used if you are having more than one word to search for. Okay, then we have the in title and in URL. Okay, and if you want to find information for a specific location and all, we give the location search operator as well. So this has to be tried by yourself. And let me say one more thing, you've got lot of Google search operators. Okay, you can use all those search operators. You can combine the search operators like what I had done earlier, like I had discussed two search operators together. One is the in URL and the file type. Similarly, you can also do such things. Okay, you can also perform, you know, combination of the search operators and do a search. Now similarly, you have something called the Google hacking database. Okay, now what does a Google hacking database mean? Google hacking database means, okay, you have something called, you have a site called exploit-db. exploit-db.com, okay, which will display all the vulnerabilities, recent, you know, vulnerable. It will display all the exploits of the recent. See, and the dates will also be given here. Now if there are any certain, if there are any vulnerabilities which was found by somebody, okay, and the exploits for such vulnerabilities, it will be published in this exploit database. Okay, now if you want to know about the Google Docs, what you can do is you can go to Google hacking database, Google see, you get, these are the docs available. Look at this. So site is site full colon gov, and in URL there should be something like admin and login, or you can give all in URL. Understood? So suppose if you, so there are a lot of Google Docs available, there are lots of pages available here as well which could be used. Okay, so which will be of use to you. Now say for example, now say that I am going to use in title webcam and in URL login. I just click on that. Okay, so see, my name is Aditya Rana and I would like to report this new Google Doc. This doc gives various online devices login page. Understood? So those devices which are connected over the net, the login page of those devices will be shown by this particular dot. So what you can do is, did you see the dot here? You can just copy it, and what you can do is you can copy it and you can give it in the Google search window. Okay, sorry, just copy it and you can give it in, yeah, you get login pages of certain online webcams. In title there should be a webcam, and in URL there should be understood. So this is called Google hacking database, wherein you get lot of exploits of the vulnerabilities. So people who find such vulnerabilities and create exploits, they publish it in this particular site, which could be used by anyone. Okay. Again, you have the Google advanced search and advanced image search. So you don't want to memorize all these operators. It's very difficult to memorize all these operators like in URL, in title, cache and all. Okay, in such cases you can go for Google advanced search and you can go for advanced image search as well. Okay, so how do you do that? To do that, what we do is, here what I'm going to do is, I'm going to give, say, Google advanced search. Okay, so this is Google advanced search. So you can, you know, narrow your search again by, you know, finding pages with all these words. You can give all details here. Okay, and you can give an advanced search which will display the result based on whatever you know, values you have given in the search operators here. Understood? That is Google's advanced search. So it is similar to giving you know, Google Docs in the search engine directly. You can come here and you don't want to give the Google Docs, you want to give it in a, you know, in a GUI way, you can give it here. Okay, and similarly there is something called Google image search. Okay, now what do you mean by image search? So you come here and so you come to this page and see, you have a camera icon here. You click on that. Okay, it's asking you, do you want to upload an image or you want to paste an image? So I have an image with me. Okay, now I don't have any image here to show an example for. I have an image with me. Okay, and I want to get the results associated with that particular image. I don't have anything to say in text in the Google search. I want just to upload that particular image to Google search engine, and I'm asking Google to give me results back, something related with that image. So you go for Google images. Okay, so that is the Google advanced search and image search. Now you want to know about the company top level domains and subdomains. Okay, so why do you require the subdomain? We require the subdomain because we will knowing about only the top level domain means we won't be able to extract that much information as possible. So I want to know, like, what all subdomains are there in that particular company as well. Okay, so now when I search for a particular organization in the search engine, I may get only the top level domains. So to get details about, you know, sub level domains, you can go to Netcraft. Okay, you can use there is a particular website called Netcraft. Okay, that will give details. It's a you know, you can use that service. Not always will it give, you know, all the information. It may give you information. Okay, you can go to that particular site. I'll just show you. And there is again another Python script called Sublister. Okay, there is a Python script called Sublister which will again list out all the subdomains of a particular source, of a particular domain that you give. Okay, so let us see what this Netcraft does. So let us take the browser, and in the browser what I'm going to do is, I'm going to give Netcraft. So this is a Netcraft site. Okay, you just come down, scroll down. Okay, so you have something like this here. Okay, what is that site running? Okay, so suppose if I give something like www.microsoft, or let us see cdat.in. Give me a minute. One second. This is working. So in the meantime, so I have a virtual machine here, okay, and in that virtual machine I have I have installed Kali Linux. You know that Kali Linux is an operating system which is having a lot of built-in penetration testing tools, and it is one of the most widely used operating system for such penetration testing sort of things. Okay, so I have a particular I have a virtual machine installed in my machine which is having Kali Linux. Okay, now what I'll do is I'll just start it. Okay, so this is a site report, so I need to give that with the protocol as well. Okay, that is why earlier I didn't get that. So I earlier I just gave www.cdac.in, so I just need to give the protocol. So I gave http://cdac.in. So this is what Netcraft has given back for me. See the site title, okay, what is the site ranking, okay, etc. You give you get the NetBlock owner, you get the name server, you get a lot of details about that particular site, which is a hosting company. CDAC itself is a hosting company. Okay, where is it hosted? It is hosted in India. Okay, which what is the IP version 4 address, IP version 6 address, range of addresses here. Okay, and you know, a lot of things are being now suppose if you have a very good knowledge about all such related things, you'll be able to understand like what is all this about and what all information you can get from this. Okay, you get the certificate transparency of CDAC website. Okay, you get the hosting history. Okay, so the operating system which is being used is Windows Server 2008. So that is again another information to the particular hacker, that Windows Server 2008. So he'll try to check out the vulnerabilities present in that particular server. Okay, then what are the technologies being used? It's using ASP.NET. okay, what are the client side technologies being used? JavaScript is being used. Okay, Ajax, jQuery, Bootstrap, and a lot of things are being used. So such things, such information, when it is being exposed in the internet, it means that lot of information will be available to the hacker as well. Okay, so this is what you get about what you get from Netcraft. So you can give any site, okay, you can give Microsoft, you can give any site. So what happens is you will get all the details. What are the name servers? So we'll get the name servers of that particular website. Okay, you get of that particular organization, you get the IP address range. Okay, who is the owner of that particular, when it is being expired. Okay, so when was it last updated, what are the technologies being used, all such things you get it from Netcraft site. Okay, when you give a particular site name. Now again, like what we had discussed earlier, we have a tool called Sublister. Okay, Sublister, which is used in Python. It is a Python script. Okay, Sublister is a Python script, and that Python script will also, what does it do? It will list the subdomains of a particular domain that you give. Okay, so you need to install Sublister, and then okay, you need to install Sublister Python script in Kali Linux, and then you should, what should you do? You should give the Sublister command to, and you should give the domain which you are trying to list the subdomains for. Okay, that will list out all the subdomains of that particular domain which you have given. So that is a tool. It is called Sublister. It is pronounced as Sublister even though it is written as Sublist 3R. Okay, the geographical location of a target? How do you get the geographical location of a target? Huh? You can use Google Maps, whatever you want, you can use. Okay. So I'll just show Kali Linux, and I'll just show how SubLister works. Okay. I'll share Kali Linux with you. Let it start. So let it start. In the meantime, we'll see some other things and we'll come back to SubLister. Okay. So I was discussing about the geographical, how to get the geographical location of a particular target. You have the Google Maps, you have Yahoo Maps, you have Google Earth tool. Using such things, you will be able to get. Now, there are social networking sites and people search services. Okay, you have certain people search services like, you know, Spokio. Okay, you have something called Namecheck. You have PIPL, IntelliS, Bean Verified, Yellow Pages. All such things are people search services. So now most of them has become you know paid websites. So I won't be able to show examples of such you know services, but you can go to www.pipl.com, and you know if you pay some amount, you can get an account and you'll be able to search for different you know people in a certain, say, in certain organizations or something like that. Okay, now you all know that social networking sites, searching for a particular person in a social networking site is easier, isn't it? What are social networking services? They are platforms. What does it do? It focuses on facilitating the building of what? Social relations among people, isn't it? Nowadays, we find lot of our childhood friends and all from social networking sites like Facebook, like Twitter. We have Instagram, you have LinkedIn. A lot of, you know, social networking sites are there. Okay. Now, what these sites, you know, they allow people to share information quickly. Okay, and what the people do is they share their personal data details as well as in the social networking site. Okay, and again in the social networking site, the problem is that a person who hasn't registered in the social networking site, sometimes they may also get information about that a particular person, or he can, you know, log in, he can sign in with a fake profile. And he can get information about the employees working in a particular organization which he is interested in. Now, what we do normally is, suppose if an event is happening in our organization, in the organization in which we are working, normally I have seen people, you know, they give it a status on the WhatsApp pages, they give it as you know, Facebook and Facebook stories. They give it, we give it in such a way. So a hacker who is interested in an organization, and if he or she has, you know, focused a particular person working in that particular organization, and he gets to know about the event of the organization, okay, from that itself he may get some of the details that he wants. So social networking sites, you know, it's very it's a very dangerous thing. I can say that it provides lots of information about the individual. Okay, so an individual, the hobbies of that individual, what is he or she interested in, all such things can be got from the sites. So the people search can social networking services provide useful information about the individual, and people search can provide critical information about a person or organization. Like PIPL and all, if you are interested in a particular person, it will give you like where all the person has recently visited and all. This PIPL search service. Gathering information from financial services. Now, what do you mean by gathering information from financial services? Gathering information means financial services, they provide a useful information about the target company, such as the market value, like what I have said earlier, of the company shares, company profile, who are the competitors of that particular company, etc. Okay, now let me see whether Kali has started. Okay. So I'm just starting a terminal here. Okay, I'm opening a terminal here in my Kali window. So this is a terminal. So what I do is you have to install sublister. Okay, so for and all, what you have to do is if you want to do that, you need to go to GitHub. You need to go to GitHub and you can search for sublister, and then you have to issue a command called git clone. Okay, you have to do such thing. So I'm not going into the all such details. I can go into such details in this short time. So what I do here is I'm just going to the sublister, you know. Okay, sublister, and what I do is I give a command like dot slash so it will start the sublister script. Okay, it will start running the sublister script. So if you want to check what all can be used with the sublister, you can give a command like hyphen hyphen help, which will give all the you know options that you can give with sublister. Okay, now suppose if I want to list out the subdomains of cdac.in, I can give sublister. Okay,
miss kaanathilla
onnu kaanunnille aa window kaanunnundo black window kaanunnundo
illa oru grey color
maatrame kaanunnullo
onnu kaanathilla
ഒരു മിനിറ്റ് ഇപ്പൊ കാണാമോ
ഇല്ല
കാണാമോ
ഇപ്പൊ കാണാം
ഓക്കെ സോ ഞാൻ ഒന്നും കൂടെ പറയാം സബ്ലിസ്റ്റർ ഓക്കെ ഞാൻ ഇത് ടെർമിനൽ ഓ ടെർമിനൽ ക്ലോസ് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ പിന്നെ ഒന്നേന്ന് ഷെയർ ചെയ്യുന്നൊക്കെ നിങ്ങൾ അല്ല ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്യുന്നൊക്കെ കണ്ടല്ലോ അല്ലേ
ഇല്ല
കാണാമോ ഞാൻ ഇവിടെ ഒരു ടെർമിനൽ ഓപ്പൺ ചെയ്തു ടെർമിനൽ വിൻഡോ ഇതിപ്പോ കാണാമോ ടെർമിനൽ വിൻഡോ കാണാമോ ഓക്കെ സോ വാട്ട് യു ഹാവ് ടു ഡു ഇസ് ഐ ലൈക് വാട്ട് ഐ ഹാവ് സെഡ് ഐ ഹാവ് ഓൾറെഡി ഇൻസ്റ്റാൾ സബ് ലിസ്റ്റർ ഓക്കെ സോ ഇഫ് യു വോണ്ട് ടു ഇൻസ്റ്റാൾ സബ് ലിസ്റ്റർ വാട്ട് യു ഹാവ് ടു ഡു ഇസ് ഗോ ടു യു നോ ജിത്ത്ഹബ് ആൻഡ് യു ഗെറ്റ് യു ഗെറ്റ് ഹൗ ടു ഇൻസ്റ്റാൾ സബ് ലിസ്റ്റർ ഫ്രം ജിത്ത്ഹബ് ഓക്കെ യു ഇൻസ്റ്റാൾ ഇറ്റ് നോ ആഫ്റ്റർ ഇൻസ്റ്റാളിംഗ് യു ഹാവ് ടു കം ടു ദാറ്റ് പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ സബ് ലിസ്റ്റർ ഡയറക്ടറി ഓക്കെ ആൻഡ് ദെൻ യു ഇഷ്യൂ എ കമാൻഡ് കോൾ സബ് ലിസ്റ്റർ ഡോട്ട് പി വൈ the python script. I'm trying to run this particular python script. Okay, so this is what you get. Now what I'm going to do is I want to list the subdomains of a particular top level domain. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm again giving the command sublister. Okay, now for giving the domain you have to give an option called hyphen d. Okay, I'm saying the least complicated option here, hyphen d, and I'm giving the say I give microsoft.com. okay, you press the enter key, so it will search in the different search engines. You can see that it is searching in Baidu, Yahoo, Google, Bing, and all. It is searching in all the publicly available databases. Okay, and it may take some error to Google, showing an error like Google probably is now is blocking a request. That may sometimes happen if you keep on requesting things in Google, it may give you such an error. Let us wait now. Let us see whether it works. Okay, let this work. Let us wait for some time. In the meantime, I will go back to the presentation and we'll see what all are there. So we're talking about the financial services of a particular company. So you can gather information. Now you can gather information from the job sites as well. Like what I had said earlier, what do you get from the job sites? You get what all technologies are being used in a job site. So you have a lot of job sites. So depending upon the country that you are in, you get the job websites differ. So in India, I think we have a very popular website, a job website called Naukri, isn't it? So what I do is the company in which I am interested in, I may go to the job website, I may check for the job requirements of that particular company. Okay, so it may say that okay, they require somebody who should be very proficient in Windows Server 12. So something like that. So then I will be able to understand that okay, the company is using what? The company is using Windows Server 2012. So likewise, you get a lot of information from the job websites as well. Now, you can monitor the target using alerts. So what do you mean by monitor the target using alerts? So you are interested in a particular thing. You are interested in a particular thing, you can get alert. Okay, now for example, say I am interested in a particular release of a particular software. So what I can do is in the Google alert, I can create an alert saying that okay, whenever something happens in the thing that I have mentioned in the Google alert, an alert should be given to me so that I'll be having up-to-date information based on my preference. Understood? So for that, what we do is okay, coming back, can you see Kali Linux now? Kali Linux Pinto. Yeah, so it's displaying all the subdomains of Microsoft. See, there are lots and lots. Okay, there are lots and lots. So you get lot of details from Sublist as well, lot of things. Okay, so this is what Sublister does. Okay, you have options to limit the results as well. Okay, so you can get that from the help which I had explained earlier. So you give like Sublister, hyphen hyphen help, and you get all the help, that all the options that you can use with the Sublister command. Okay, if you want to save the result to a text file and all, you can use a output option, O option, hyphen O option. So that all you can just go through. And you can verify the result after writing that to a text file and all. Okay. And you can, again, you don't want to search all the search engines. You don't want to search all the search engines. You are not interested in all. You are interested only in certain search engines. And you can give an hyphen E and you can mention which are like Google, Baidu and all. You are, or say Bing and all. So you can just mention the search engines which you are interested in by giving an hyphen E option as well. Okay. So that is what we were discussing about. That was what we were discussing about. Now, so I've just searched for Google Alerts. Okay, so I have a Google Alert here. It will take me to the alerts page. Create an alert about what? Okay, so I say I'm interested in, say, iPhone. I'm interested in iPhone, or say I'm interested in some other Android releases or something like that. So I can give the my preference in which I am interested in, and it creates an alert. And what Google does is whenever
it's not visible, man.
So whenever it is, so I can create an alert here, okay, and that will give me alerts about whatever I have given in here. So any information about that particular preference which I have given, anything happens in that particular preference which I have given here happens, Google will suddenly give me an alert. So in such ways, you can get information about whatever you are interested in. And like group forums and blogs, so groups, forums and all for all certain organizations will be having forums. Like you have you have lot of e-learning you know websites, like they'll be having forums, okay? Or some organizations will be having, some persons will be having blogs, some organizations will be having groups. Like what I have discussed earlier, the person who is interested in may create a fake profile and get inside that, and they may get information what the employees are, you know, exchanging in between. They may discuss about something technical, they may discuss something about the organization as well. They might think that everybody in the group are, you know, legitimate people. So from such groups, forums and blogs, people may get information, okay? Now, to determine the operating system, we have Netcraft. So I've shown the Netcraft. Okay, then we have the Shodan search engine. So Shodan search engine, it is for IoT devices. So devices which are connected over the net. Now, suppose if you want to see the devices which are there in a particular city in India, or say a particular city in Kerala in India, and you are interested about which all you want to see which all webcams are available. So those which are available will be shown by the Shodan search engine. Okay. Now I cannot currently show the Shodan search engine because I don't remember my user ID and password of Shodan. So I can't show that. You can just try it out. How to use Shodan? You should have an account in Shodan as well. Okay. Then we have another search engine, Census. That is also a powerful search engine which will, you know, give details about networks, organization, domains, and all. Okay. Now, like what we have said, we have the social engineering on social networking sites. They perform a sort of social engineering. So attackers, they use social engineering tricks. For example, one over here, users maintain the profile. What the attacker gets is contact information and location. The users connect to friends and chat. So friends list and friends information will be taken by the attacker. They share photos and videos. So it is an identity of the family members, interests, etc. They may play game. They may join groups. So that shows the interest of the user. So they create events. They create events, and that shows the activities that the user is good in. Okay, now when it comes to an organization, in organizations, social profile and all, there may be user surveys that shows the business strategies of that particular organization. They try to promote products. Okay. So you get the product profile and all. Suppose if some exhibition or something is happening, and of all the products of that particular organization, they get the profile of the product. Okay. Then the user support, which will help the attacker to perform social engineering. Recruitments, they get the platforms and technologies. Now they try to background check. Okay, and to hire employees, and that will help the attacker to identify what type of business is being done in that particular organization. Okay, now we have something called website footprinting. Website footprinting means getting the information, or I'm getting the details of a particular website. So to get the details of a particular website, you have lot of highly powerful tools. Like you have something called Burp Suite, which is a widely used tool. You have something called Saproxy, Paros Proxy, okay, website informer. Then you have a extension in Firefox called Firebug. Okay, so these all are very good tools which helps you to footprint a website. When I say footprinting a website, when I say footprinting a network, when I say footprinting a server, it also says collecting information about that. Okay, so website footprinting refers to monitoring and analyzing the target organization's website. Okay, so what all information you get? Software use, operating system, you get the subdirectories and parameters, you get the file name, you get the path, Okay, you get the file names when sometimes you get the file names of the details of the users, their accounts and passwords as well. You get the contact details, you get the CMS details, content management system details, and also this is here, they have shown a snapshot of the Burp Suite, okay, which is a very good tool, which is a very good tool used in web application hacking as well, okay. You can also examine the HTML source code. Okay, now once you have a website with you, you can just take that HTML source code and you may get information from the comments. Okay, sometimes if you're using a CMS, the CMS itself will generate some comments and you may get a lot of valuable things from that. Okay, maybe details of the database or something like that, contact details of the web developer or admin, file system structure and script types. Say they may be using some jQuery, some sort of you know, web technologies. So all such details will be got from the HTML source code. Okay, and again, if you examine the cookies that the server is generating, you may get information about which all scripting platforms are, like, is it JavaScript or is there any other scripting which is being used. Okay, what are the softwares in use? All such things can be got from the cookies. Okay, now what do you mean by mirroring an entire website? Mirroring an entire website means, see, each and every time I try to get into a website and I try to gather as much information from the website, it means what? It means sometimes I'll be caught, or sometimes you know, the website administrator or sometimes a network administrator or whoever, he might get a person is trying to get into this a lot of time. Okay, so I will be able to spend as much time as I want to get all the details about that particular website. So what I'll be doing is I'll be mirroring the site. Mirroring the site means what? I'll be getting a local copy of the website which I am interested in. I'm getting a local copy. Everything that is present in that website, I'll get a local copy of that. Okay, and I can perform all my footprinting in that particular local copy. So I need not go to the live website. So what all are there, I'll get it in the local copy and I can work on that. Okay, so mirroring an entire website onto the local system will enable an attacker to browse the website offline. Okay, so it helps us in getting the directory structure, okay, without giving multiple requests. Okay. Yeah, so what does web mirroring tool allows you to download a website to a local directory, building recursively all directories, HTML, images, flash videos, etc. So one of the tools which could be used for that is the HTTrack website copier. This is a very good tool which is used for mirroring an entire website. Okay, I'll just show a you know, glimpse of that because we don't have enough time for showing the complete working of the thing. So what you can do is you can just, one second, you can see the site, you can see the browser, no? So I just give a search, HTTrack website copier. Is this visible? Yes. Okay. So you can go to the HTTrack website copier site and you have a download option here. You can go to that, and depending upon what type of operating system and platforms you are using, you choose the appropriate file to download. Okay. After downloading this, this is an exe file that you'll be downloading. After downloading that, what you can do is you can just, you know, install it. Okay. Now, after installing, one second. I'll just share with you. Okay, so this is the WinHTTrack website copier. You'll see this. So what you can do is, this is a welcome page that you get. This is a page that you get. So you can click on the next button here. So when you click on the next button, it will ask you, you can give a project name, anything that you want. Okay, say I'm going to give something, let's say test. Test a demo. Okay. a project category and all, you can leave it blank, you know, and you can give the path to which you want to save your the directory in, the website in, the local, the copy of the website where you wherever you want to see, you have to give the base path here. Understood? So by default it comes in the C drive, my websites. It creates a folder of its own. So if you want, you can change the path and you can give it anywhere that you want. So once you have given the base path, you can click on the next window. Okay, and here you have lots of options. Okay, so whichever website you are interested in, you give the URL of that particular website. Okay, so for example, I am giving something like www.certifiedhacker.com. okay, so this is a dummy site wherein we can perform all sorts of, you know, searches and all. So this is what I have you know, added. This is a URL which I have given. Now there is something called the set option. So before that, let me tell you, I have a help menu here from which I get the help of all the options that is given over here. Okay, so you have a lot of options. You can just go through the help here. Okay, and it will help you in that. It will help you in all the options. Okay, then there we have something called set options here. Okay, where we can define all such options, what all we want. Okay, now for example, we have something called scan rules. So if you want all the GIF, all the SIP, all the movie files, etc., everything from the website to be downloaded as a local copy, you can use that. Okay, then you can click on okay. I have given my all my set option and you click on next. So when you click on next, it's asking you, shall it disconnect when it is finished? So I just click on that. If you don't give, also no problem, it will wait there unless you do something. You click on the finish button. When you click on finish button, it will start downloading the website which you have mentioned. Okay, so it may take some time depending upon what all you have given. Understood? So that is how you go. Now once you have once a download is completed, you can go to see full colon my websites folder and you get the entire directory structure of the website that has been locally copied to your system, and you can just you know, go through that taking time of your own. Okay, so this is how you do the HT track. So I'm clicking on the cancel button because I don't want to do this. Okay, so that is what happens here. Let me go back to my slide again. So that is for HTTrack website copier. Okay, now you have something called archive.org. You have a site called archive.org that is called the Wayback Machine, and when you give a particular site, it will give all the archived versions. Like we have seen a Google search operator called cache, isn't it? What does cache do? It will just give the recent cache. Okay, but this archive.org, what it does is it will give me back everything. Okay, I hope you can see this. So what is that? archive.org. take the browser and go to archive.org. okay, this is a Wayback Machine. So enter the URL. So I am going to give microsoft.com. so the Wayback Machine will give me a calendar, okay, from which it will show, see the snapshots of all the versions. Can you see now? It's recently showing 2020. See what happened on August 9th, what happened on August 10th, in such time, at such times. Okay, so you can go through all the archived versions of the you know, web page that you are interested in. So you can choose a year. Okay, so choose a graph again. You can choose a year and you can choose the appropriate date of which you are interested in. Okay, so suppose I go to say, go to an HTTP 302 response. it's taking some time to get the page. So this is how you do. Okay, so you are interested in a particular website and you want to see what happened on that particular day. How did it look like? Yeah, so this was how it looked like. Okay, all right. Then you can monitor the web page. So you have some, you have certain tools like website watcher and all. So what does a website watcher do is it allows you to automatically check the web pages that you are interested in for updates and changes. So it will give you an email. Now suppose you are interested in a particular web page, okay, and suppose if any update or any change happened in that particular website or web page, you will be informed by sending a mail to your account. There are tools for that. One such tool is the website watcher. So you can monitor the web page, the web pages that you are interested in for such updations and changes. Then you have competitive intelligence gathering. So competitive intelligence gathering means what? Whichever organization you are interested in, you want to know about the competitors of that particular company, you can perform a competitive intelligence gathering. So you can identify, gather, analyze, verify, and use information about the competitors from resources such as internet. Okay, so you can they are non-interfering and subtle in nature. So you can social, so these are the different sources of competitive intelligence. So there isn't anything particular to say about this. So if you want to know, like, when did a company begin, how did it develop, who is leading it, where is it located and all, you get a lot of information about the company. You have something called the Edgar database, you have something called Hoover's, Businessware, LexisNexis and all. Okay, so you go to such sites and you give the company name which you are interested in, it will give you back the details. Okay, now you can perform a whois lookup. Okay, now what does whois lookup, what does whois lookup do? So the whois lookup will return, it is a query and response protocol. I can say that whois is a query and response protocol that gives you registrant information about any particular domain. Okay, for example, suppose if I want to buy a domain, so I may go to GoDaddy or I may go to some other provider like the Namecheap, somebody like that. Okay, and I may ask for a domain name and they give me a domain name. So this information is what you get from whois. Who has given you that? Okay, and there are databases, there are whois databases which are maintained by regional internet registries. Understood? There are different regional internet registries, like you have ARIN, you have AFRINIC, you have RIPE-NCC, you have LACNIC, you have APNIC, where each one is for each region. Okay, this is for AFRINIC, is for Africa, this is for America. Okay, APNIC is for Asia Pacific. So this is what whois lookup does. Okay, so you have tools in Kali Linux and in Windows which perform a whois, and you can go to certain websites where you can perform a whois lookup. Okay, so for that, what I'll do is I'll just show how to get the whois details. Okay, so I give like whois. Enter the domain name. I give like say cdac.in and I perform a search here. So I get the domain information. See, the registrar is who has given me the domain name, Endurance Domains Technology, registered on, expires on, updated on. Okay. Name servers. These are the name servers which are available. Registrant contact. This is a state from which the contact of the registrant. Okay. So certain other details, okay, you get it from whois. So if you want to get such information about a particular domain, like who is the registrant and all, you can go to whois. And in Kali also you have tool called Whoist. You can simply give Whoist and you give the domain that you are interested in. It will give the domain information. It will give the, all the domain information that is maintained by the Whoist database by the regional registries that we have seen right now. Okay. Again, there are certain Whoist lookup tools which are available in Windows and in Kali as well. Next is footprinting through social engineering. Footprinting through social engineering means, social engineering means what? It is an art of exploiting human behavior to extract. I think you have a module on social engineering later, to extract the confidential information. So social engineers depend on the fact that people are unaware of their valuable information and are careless about protecting it. Okay, somehow you get to extract their confidential information by talking too much to the person and all. Okay, so what does the social engineers do? They get the credit card details and social security number, maybe some usernames and passwords, okay, operating system software versions, network layout information, IP addresses and names of servers. And what are the techniques? Eavesdropping, yeah, shoulder surfing, yeah, dumpster diving, impersonation, etc. Now, what does that mean? Eavesdropping means what? You're listening to some others. It's unauthorized listening of conversations or reading of messages. Understood? It's the interception of any form of communication such as audio, video, written. Shoulder surfing means what? You are saying, I'm sitting here. Okay, and I'm working in my laptop. Okay, I'm trying to log into my bank account. Okay, and a person is standing beside me. He pretends as if he is talking to somebody else or he is looking somewhere else, but he tries to surf over my shoulder and get what all I'm typing. Okay, so a technique that is secretly observe the target to gain the critical information, such as passwords, personal pins and all. Okay, now what do you mean by dumpster diving? Dumpster diving means getting something from the trash. Okay, maybe some phone bills, contact information, financial information from the bins. Okay, waste bins. That is what dumpster diving means. Okay, so there are lot of footprinting tools which are there. Something called FOCA is there. Okay, FOCA, that's a footprinting tool which you can download it by yourself. Okay, then there is another tool which can be used in Kali called Recon-NG. Okay, Recon-Dog is also there. Again, another powerful tool is there, Recon-NG. Then you have a tool called Multego. There's a tool called Multego. Okay, that is a visual tree tool. Okay, which will give you again lot of information about the domain, subdomains and all. Okay, so what are the footprinting countermeasures? Footprinting countermeasure, whatever we have seen right till now, countermeasures means what? You shouldn't do all such things. Okay, for example, restrict the employees to access a social networking site from the organization's network. Configure the web servers to avoid information leakage. You don't leave it with the default configuration. Configure it. Educate employees to use pseudonyms on blogs, groups, and forums. Okay. Then do not reveal critical information like press releases, annual reports, and all. What all are being published on the website, limit the amount of information. Then if any sensitive information is being discovered in the website which is publicly available, don't do that. Okay, don't cache the web pages.